Coming up, the line to get your free vaccination donut was probably longer this week than the line at your local polling station. No matter, we track what you had to say at the ballot box and why. Plus, our two governors are emphatic, no to vaccine passports.
We'll never do that mandated.
Also this half hour, with Kansas now ditching mask mandates, is the pressure now building on our schools?
We're not going to begin until the gentleman in the back either wears a mask or leaves.
And straight ahead, the homeless refusing to back down, and Kansas City's All-Star dreams dashed. But could there be more disappointment ahead?
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Nick Haines, your host and guide through the week's most impactful news stories, dissected by the journalists who report and cover them. Checking in with us on the big screen this week, Mr. Up to Date on KCUR-FM, Steve Kraske, from the Investigation Unit at 41 Action News, Kat Reid, from the Kansas City Call newspaper, Eric Wesson, and from the pages of your Kansas City Star, Dave Helling. Kansas Cityans went to the polls this week, but there were longer lines outside Krispy Kreme than were at your local polling station. 10% of voters bothering to show up to cast a ballot. That's the turnout. As a quick recap, here are four results worth mentioning. While there wasn't a big turnout, there were plenty of big wins. How about 77% of voters saying yes to renewing the earnings tax? The chair of the Kansas City, Missouri School Board is ousted by voters. The Park Hill School District elects its first black school board member, and the Lee Summit School Board now has two black elected members 18 months after Superintendent Dennis Carpenter handed in his resignation to an all-white board, unhappy with his plans to expand racial equity programs. Okay, just some of the results and trends. Steve Kraske, the biggest surprise and lesson from this last election on Tuesday was what?
Well, I think you always have to point to the fact, Nick, that in a low turnout election, unexpected things happen. Certainly the upset of Patty Manser as the chairwoman of the school board would rank really high up there. But man, just think about this for a moment. Kansas City's largest revenue source, the earnings tax, is contingent on an election in which 8 or 10% of voters turn out. If you're the mayor of this city or a council member, you aren't going to rest very easily any election time when that earnings tax is on the ballot, because you never know when an upset could happen. People would turn against it and throw that revenue source out the window.
And isn't that why, by the way, Dave Helling, that in Kansas they moved local elections from this time of year and moved them to November in hopes of getting a higher turnout?
Right. And generally speaking, Nick, higher turnouts are always better for government than lower turnouts. The more people vote, the better the decision making tends to be. By contrast, people who run elections like low turnout elections, because they can figure out who their base supporters are and get them to the polls, and that's been the case for the three earnings tax elections in Kansas City. The same folks are voting. The folks who enjoy the earnings tax, like it, support it, because in part they don't pay it. They tend to be retired, and again, the earnings tax isn't assessed against unearned income. So, the political thinking here is very clear. I'm not sure it's the best thing for democracy.
Kat, what was the big surprise and lesson for you from Tuesday's vote?
You know, I would look at the school board races in Kansas City and really the influence that Black KC had on this race, which is a 501c4 group. They put a lot of money into these school board races. We still don't know the origins of the money, although, you know, it's not required to be disclosed. I think that that group is going to have a big impact as time goes on in future school board races. And then I also just wanted to point out about the earnings tax. There really was no formal or any kind of campaign against the earnings tax. As I know in the past, there had been more vocal opposition to it. So I think that that helped kind of the margin of victory for the earnings tax this time around.
Eric.
I agree with Kat. I think $150,000 into a school board election is very, what's the right word, interesting. And I think that what we're going to have happen, the other two candidates, I think it's other two seats come open in another couple of years, it'll probably be another $150,000, $200,000. And it makes you wonder, is this about the kids or is this about changing over public schools in the charter schools? Is this what the Kauffman people really wanted to do? And I think that's the most compelling thing that I took from the election. What's going to be the cap? You got $150,000. Most people would call it dark money. But for a school board race, which is really a volunteer position, why would they dump that much money in that race?
Well, also this week, Kansas City officials were salivating over the prospect of hosting the All-Star Game again. You may remember it was here back in 2012. Major League Baseball dangled the prospect after abruptly yanking the June event from Atlanta following controversy over a new state election law. But local hopes were dashed when it was announced the All-Star Game is heading to Denver. Was this just wishful thinking, Dave Helling, or did Kansas City really believe it had a shot of hosting one of baseball's biggest events?
Well, both. I mean, I think it was wishful thinking, but I do think that some people in Kansas City thought that there might be some reason that Major League Baseball would want to come here, particularly because of the existence of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum and the 100th anniversary that was missed basically a year ago because of COVID. And there was some thought that if the if Major League Baseball wanted to celebrate the contributions of the Negro League players, it could do so at the All-Star Game here. But Nick, the reality is that Missouri and Kansas are both taking a close look at changing their election laws and making it harder to vote. Major League Baseball might have found itself in the same boat if either state did those things.
Isn't that a cautionary tale then, Dave? We don't know what's going to happen in the future, whether it be a Kansas legislature or a Missouri legislature. It might be restricting transgender rights. It could be changing election laws. It could be an ill-timed Steve Kraske police shooting here in Kansas City. And that might even influence the NFL draft. That's coming in 2023. And the NFL will pull that from us.
I think you have a good point, Nick. And I think the enduring lesson here is very simple. And that is, if you disrespect people, if you discriminate against people, we're seeing a new awakening, if you will, among corporate America, corporate heads saying we aren't going to stand by that and support events in states that undertake those kinds of activities.
Doesn't that have a chilling effect, though, on a city like Kansas City, who wants to always bid on these big events, Kat?
I don't know if the NFL would be, would behave in the same way as the MLB, for instance, in moving a draft. I think it just varies depending on what the event is. But, you know, it's something we'll just have to wait and see how it pans out.
And Eric, you know, it was recently that the mayor was trying to get, at least on a temporary basis, the Toronto NBA team to come and house themselves here because of traveling from Canada to the United States was so problematic during the pandemic. But didn't we have black leaders say, no, NBA, don't come here because of treatment of black people in Missouri?
Yeah, you had the Urban League, SCLC, actually sent a letter to the NBA officials saying there's too many problems here. And this was during the unrest after George Floyd's murder. And I agree with Dave. I thought they would come here and do the All-Star Game here just out of recognition for Negro Leagues baseball.
Now, there was a recent story that claimed a shocking number of Americans weren't signing up for the vaccine because they didn't know they were eligible. This week, you are left in no doubt. If you live in Kansas or Missouri, it no longer matters how old you are, what you do for a living, or your medical history. If you're 16 years of age or older, you qualify. Of course, there's a big difference between being eligible for the COVID vaccine and actually snagging an appointment for the shot. Around here, waiting lists remain frustratingly long, and the system still favors those with smartphones, ready transportation, and the luxury of being able to drop everything at a moment's notice. Does that help explain, Steve Kraske, why, for instance, Wyandotte County has half the vaccination rate of neighboring Johnson County?
I think that's probably exactly right, Nick. I've talked to residents in Wyandotte County who are struggling with transportation issues to get to vaccination sites. And, you know, it's just a reality of life in a county that's probably the poorest county in the Kansas City metro. It clearly remains a big issue in Wyandotte County.
And so half as many people, Kat Reid, in Wyandotte County as Johnson County, even though they have the loosest rules for COVID vaccinations in the entire metropolitan area. You can just show up anywhere, no appointment necessary.
I think that that was an effort to kind of battle some of these challenges. But a spokesperson for the Wyandotte County Health Department also said they're battling misinformation about the vaccine, and they're launching a new communications campaign surrounding that. So that's a factor that you need to consider as well.
We hear about all of these efforts to reach out to underserved communities, Eric. And on this program a few weeks ago, you said, well, they had a vaccination event at the Negro League Baseball Museum, and 90% or more were white people, even though it was there for people around the 18th and Vine Jazz District. Have you noticed a change now?
No, it seems to be the same. It's not as many people now, but it seems to be the same. I do still think they need to do better marketing in the Black community.
And I would add to that, Nick, that the entire structure seems to be centered around the idea that everyone has access to a computer, everyone has email accounts, everybody has a smartphone, everybody has some sort of digital interface, if you will, with a hospital system. That just isn't true. I mean, we ran into this with schools, too, where everybody just assumed, well, we can go to online learning because everybody's got a computer. That just isn't the case, particularly in more economically challenged parts of our community like Wyandotte County. And so to depend on that structure to get in, vaccines into arms, I think was always going to be a problem from the beginning. And I think we're seeing the results of some of that.
You know, a big question is what happens now. While there's been a lot of talk about making vaccinations mandatory, Dr. Anthony Fauci says the federal government won't move forward with any plans to enact a vaccination passport system. And Kansas Governor Laura Kelly and Missouri Governor Mike Parson say they have no interest in vaccine passports either.
If the private sector wants to do that, I'm fine with that. If they want to do that, if a business owner or somebody wants to. But as far as the state goes, we won't mandate vaccine passports.
So even though businesses want to do that, but if the states are not going to do it, does that take the wind out of their sails, Kat, and going to make them demure and be reluctant to impose policies on their staff that they have to be jabbed or they don't get a job, for instance?
I think some private companies will still consider doing this, but what remains to be seen is if the legislature takes action to ban vaccine passports. I know the Missouri Senate took some steps towards that. And in Kansas, they're also talking about legislation that would prevent an employer from penalizing an employee who chooses not to get the vaccine. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Throw this in quickly? Governor Mike Parson was a little bit to the left of his party. Yeah. When he said, in essence, hey, private businesses, if you want to do that, go ahead. The Republicans in the legislature want to prohibit businesses from requiring vaccine proof before you go to the movies or before you get a job or things like that. And I think that's the real trend to watch, not necessarily whether the governments issue vaccine passports or not.
Well, another interesting trend, and I want to get your take on this, Steve, because you also wear the hat of a journalism professor at one of our top universities in our region. But I noticed now that KU, MU, K-State, UMKC all saying, no, we're not going to require our students to be vaccinated. Now, I know over this pandemic year, you have been teaching online, haven't you? Does that mean that they want you to be coming back in the classroom, even with unvaccinated students coming this fall?
Yeah, absolutely, Nick. The word here on campus is they want us to go back in person in the fall. And personally, I can't wait because I am so tired of Zoom calls. I just got my second shot a couple days ago, so I'll be ready to go come this fall. And if students choose not to do it and want to take that risk, that'll really fall on their shoulders.
So that doesn't bother you if you have half your class there of students not vaccinated?
It wouldn't be an issue for me, Nick.
I do see that Johnson County Community College also, by the way, now offering all of its staff $250 if you have proof of vaccination, just to incentivize that without the government being involved whatsoever. What is UMKC offering you? A brand new iPhone 12? A bucket full of cash?
No, and no, and no, and no one here okay. is going to be surprised to hear that. I wish that was the case. Maybe Eric Wesson will kick in something for me for getting a shot. I don't know.
Kat.
Yeah, I think you are more likely, though, at least for the time being, to see incentives rather than penalties. You know, Krispy Kreme now, you can get a free donut if you bring your vaccine card in. So incentives left and right.
What I want is $250 worth of donuts. If I could do that, then I would be a happy man.
Well, forget about vaccines. Whether to wear a mask or not continues to be a contentious issue this week. This is the first week in which there is no mask mandate in Kansas. And that's also putting pressure on schools. A new state law requires school boards to conduct a hearing if a parent challenges the district's COVID rules. And it's causing plenty of frayed nerves. This is a meeting of the school board in Blue Valley this week.
We're not going to begin until the gentleman in the back either wears a mask or leaves. Sorry.
This man sitting at the back of the room refusing to wear a mask or leave.
I think we're just going to have to clear the room and start over.
Police officers confronting the unmasked man face to face, then again after the room cleared.
Talking about that?
Ultimately, district personnel announced the meeting was off.
Conceivably, couldn't we see hundreds now of these challenges? And you have to have a hearing of a school board if one parent complains. All of this happening, even though we've just got a few weeks left of the school year, Kat?
I mean, we could certainly see more, and that is the major concern that educational leaders have about this system. I think, you know, it'll depend on how these first few play out if we start to see more, but it's a big concern. And then also, you know, if the parent doesn't like the school board's decision, they can go to a judge, and then there's a hearing that has to be held within 72 hours. And the school district has a pretty, like, high standard that they have to meet to show they use the most or the least restrictive means possible. And, you know, this was a really a necessary measure. So,
and if the judge does say that, that it is a little bit too punitive, then the school district has to remove its mask mandate, Dave.
At least according to the statute, and it does, as Kat suggests, set up an enormous challenge for school districts who will find themselves running to the courthouse more often than they'd want to. You know, Nick, the discussion about masks for the last year has been one of the more astonishing debates of my time in journalism. It's just amazing how political it has turned out to be, and I think we're just seeing more evidence of that now.
Now, some news stories are just plain confusing. One story that seemed to be as clear as mud this week was about Kansas City's response to rising homelessness. There were several reports that two homeless tent cities in Westport and on the grounds of City Hall were being dismantled and the occupants told to leave. Yet the mayor and a city spokesman both claimed there was no effort to evict occupants from their makeshift homes. Which is it, Eric Wesson?
Well,
that's part of the, that's why it's as clear as mud. The polls tells it all.
They posted, and I don't know whether it was the homeless people that did it, but they posted some paperwork that looked like eviction. So I'm going to say that the mayor kind of backpedaled. It depends on what day and what time you woke up, which story you believe.
We just saw that sign, by the way, and it did say you had to be out by Sunday. And, yeah. and the mayor then says, Steve, that no, that is an official notification, yes, but it doesn't mean you have to leave.
That's exactly, I'm going to read the mayor's quote here. That was okay. Just the official notification, but I don't necessarily think it's a trigger of any type of enforcement activity. I don't know what that means, but the homeless folks, to my way of thinking, are being pretty demanding in terms of what they want and what they expect here. They seem to think they have some political clout. I'm not convinced they do, but the mayor is showing an enormous amount of patience with them as he works through this issue.
Kat.
You know, no one has committed to saying, oh, if they're not gone by this date, we're going to clear the camp. That has never been decided. Right now, I think they're working through some short-term and long-term solutions. For instance, the folks in the encampments have talked a lot about wanting additional porta potties, especially after City Hall grounds. There were apparently some bodily fluids in the fountain and an air vent. So that's something they're talking through. But then also the mayor is talking about maybe extending contracts with hotels to house people who don't have houses currently. So you're seeing a mixture of things, but no one can really say what's going to happen tomorrow.
I think that situation should have got resolved when the first tent was put out there. They should have addressed that. Now it's escalated to a situation where it's totally out of control.
But my view on that, Dave Helling, is that the mayor ran as the mayor, as he said on the campaign trail, that I'm going to be running for the poor people of the city. And so it's going to be very hard for him then, as somebody who was homeless himself, to then look at the situation and then be seen to have a very strong arm in dealing with the most vulnerable in our society.
Well, that's exactly right. Two things, Nick. First, if Eric Wesson doesn't know what's going on, no one knows what's going on. Just keep that in mind. And second, I talked to the mayor about this at length this week. I think he is a bit frustrated that alternatives that are provided for the folks that are involved in these protests are not being accepted. Understanding or seeing clearly what the end game is difficult for Mayor Quentin Lucas and other people surrounding this problem.
We've talked here before, Nick, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact in terms of just how complicated this issue is. Much more involved than just providing someone a place to stay. There are issues with utilities going forward, the cost of refurbishing those homes. Mental health issues are enormous here. This is a tough one here. Don't expect a solution that's gonna please everybody anytime soon.
But there is an effort, though, at the national level. President Biden, in his infrastructure plan, beyond in trillions of dollars, yes, for roads and bridges, but also for human infrastructure, Kat Reid, that the mayor says may bring, you know, thousands of retrofitted and new homes for low income in Kansas City.
Yeah, I mean, it depends if we get the tax credits and the grants, but it is very much based on an expansive tax credit program that would help retrofit homes, build affordable housing. And part of that is providing funding to areas that don't have exclusionary zoning laws. So you might see some changes to zoning to help clear the way to build more homes. Another thing I just want to mention quickly, I think in terms of the encampment, they want to see concrete policy change before they leave. So I don't think that we'll see that camp disband because alternatives that are temporary are offered to them. They want something that's long-term and they want it promised on paper.
We have a viewer, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. His name is John and he lives in Kansas, who tells me every single week how many minutes I have talking about Missouri side issues and how many minutes are talked about on Kansas issues. So I want to end this program on a Kansas side issue. I don't know if you saw that former Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is back in the spotlight, at least temporarily. He appears in a new campaign announcement video this week.
I know leadership. I know what it takes. I know it takes grit. And I know a leader when I see one, and that is why I'm supporting Amanda Adkins for Congress.
Remember her, Amanda Adkins, the Johnson County Republican who lost to Sharice Davids last year in the Kansas 3rd Congressional District? She wants a rematch. She lost by 10 points. Steve, why does Adkins think she has any chance of claiming this seat this time around?
Well, she very well could have a better chance this time, Nick. She has two things going for her she didn't have last time. One, she might have a newly redrawn district that would favor a Republican over a Democrat, add some Republican voters to the 3rd District of Kansas. Republicans are very close to getting a majority in Washington. There's going to be a big push to redraw districts that favor Republicans in Republican states like Kansas. And two, it's a midterm election, Nick. Republicans should, in theory, will have a much better year in 2022 than they did in 2020.
And the changing of that district that Steve Kraske talked about, Dave Helling, could involve cutting up Wyandotte County, is one proposal, cutting it in half, which is a reliably Democratic area, to give more votes to the Republican. That seems an incredibly audacious move.
Right, because if you cut it in half, you might have to put part of Wyandotte County in the 1st District, which stretches all the way to the Colorado border. That's going to be tough. Everyone who watches this show, Nick, needs to pay close attention to the redistricting efforts at the state and national level over the next 6 to 12 months, because it will really dictate a lot of how we're represented in Washington and, for that matter, in Topeka and Jefferson
City. Lots of lawsuits.
There are lots of lawsuits.
When you put a program like this together every week, you can't get to every story grabbing the headlines. What was the big local story we missed?
Still a big no from Missouri lawmakers for funding voter-approved Medicaid expansion. The longtime leader of the Guadalupe Center abruptly retires after being placed on administrative leave. No one's talking, but an outside firm has been hired to launch a workplace investigation. Remember this woman? She tried to unseat Roy Blunt. Robin Carnahan, now nominated by the president to lead the General Services Administration. And the Kansas Shakespeare Festival canceled for a second year in a row amid continuing COVID concerns. If an outdoor festival in June can't happen, some see it as a worrying sign that bringing back performers and big audiences is going to be a lot tougher than expected.
Eric Wesson, was it one of those stories or something completely different?
Something completely different. We had an opportunity this week to take a tour as we reach the halfway point for the construction of the airport. It looks like it's going to be a phenomenal place to be introduced to Kansas City. And when you leave, you'll have everlasting memories of Kansas City.
Kat.
I'm going with something completely different, which is a very high-profile trial currently going on in our area, the trial of Kyler Yeust in Cass County, accused of killing Kara Kopetsky and Jessica Runyans. We recently won a huge First Amendment victory that television stations, media in Kansas City, to get a camera in the courtroom to cover that trial every step.
Steve.
Medicaid expansion in Missouri, Nick. Keep this in mind here. Voters last August approved a constitutional amendment in Missouri to expand Medicaid. Just in the last couple of weeks, the Missouri House said, we're not going to fund it. It's an unbelievable development. It's going to result in a huge court fight if that decision sticks. We'll see what the Missouri State Senate does.
Dave Helling.
Two quick things. Kat Reid had an important story about the airport this week, talking about the efforts to meet WBE and MBE goals at KCI, and it appears both of those goals are being met, just barely, but they're being met, but that only about 13% of the workforce at the airport is actually live in Kansas City, Missouri, and that's going to cause some heartache for some people. And second, a breaking story that Rick Smith, the police chief, may end up at a fundraiser for the Jackson County Republican Party that's scheduled for April 17th. That is going to cause no end of heartburn in the corridors of City Hall. Mayor Lucas has already criticized it.
Which has speakers Eric Greiton and Eric Schmidt, all both running for
and
the United States
McCluskey,
Senate.
And the McCluskeys of St. Louis, who famously raised guns during a George Floyd protest.
And we do pre-record this program, so it is possible that by all of this, after all of the fuss, that Rick Smith may end up saying, oh, you were mistaken, I'm not going, I didn't realize what was happening. But there we have it. That is our week, and it has been reviewed. Our thanks to Kat Reid from 41 Action, who's always on call at the Kansas City Call, Eric Wesson, the Star's Dave Helling, and keeping you up to date weekdays at 9 on KCOR-FM, Steve Kraske. And I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, be well, keep calm, and carry on.